Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Hey, let me tell you something. As we start this morning, every night I read 15 minutes. Sometimes I make it 5 minutes, 10 minutes, put the book down, I'm gone. But I've been reading these detective series. They're real easy. It's fun, you know? You can watch it in your head as you're reading. John runs after the bad guy, and they get in the van, and they get away. And I was thinking of last night when I finished this book. It took me like 2 months. I'm a slow reader. And I'm reading a story. But you know what reality is when we come in here this morning? We're all in the midst of our story. And God's part of our story in Christ. And we're all in a story. And I took a little couple notes because I got up extra early this morning because I still woke up at the normal time. Is that... in your story, I think one of the reasons we come to church and we worship the Lord, part of the experience of God in church is that we tell God our story in prayer. We come to God with our story today, and we lay our story at God's feet, right? We say, God, man, like, I can only do my part, but, like, it's your story through me. And this morning, as we come in our own story, whatever that is, I want to encourage you to have faith. I want to encourage you to have faith when there's no common sense anymore, in my opinion. To trust God, to run towards God in mercy, not run from God in sin, but to run God towards mercy and grace. And I want to encourage you to just hold on tight to God. When I say this a lot, when the world tries to talk you out of God. So this morning, in our very own story, and someone's story is different than their story and that, let's just take a moment this morning and let's just pray and tell God your story for a few moments. That story can be you're excited today, or you came here with a lot of stuff, and that's okay too. So let's just pray this morning. Jesus, we come before you this morning. And we give you our story. We don't know what that may be for each and every individual, but we come before you and we lay it at the cross, we lay it at the feet of who you are in a posture of prayer and a posture of humility, and we come to you this morning. It may be words of praise, it may be words of, God, help me. But we come here this morning in these moments together as a body of Christ, and we come to you. Lord, may you be with us the rest of this time together. May we sing from our hearts. May we hear your word. Regardless who is up here speaking, it's not their word, it's your word. And we thank you that we can collectively come together in the body of Christ. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, you're up, Grace. Thank you.
Sleep. That was my favorite day of the year, fall back. Why don't you all stand with me and worship the Lord this morning.
Joy still comes in the morning.
still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your hands and keep singing.
Still alive and breathing.
Thank you, Grace. Hey, you know what? This fits in. See, I was handed this bag to put in the church kitchen for one of the ministries. And why we worship God, right? This is worship too, right? Remember we talked about that? So it's kind of cool. You know, I tend to, on Sunday mornings, I sing, you know. I'm sure I'm really good at it, but and I watch everyone, how everyone differently sings. It's so cool, because some people, you know, the sections over here are like, yeah. And then, like, I'm in this section where I listen and I feel it. And then, well, Donna Shield are off the mat, whatever they do. But it's all worshiping God. It's all coming to God. It's like throwing your story before God. That's what I was talking about earlier today. But a couple quick, you got it or I got it? I got it. Couple quick announcements. I know these sound redundant sometimes, but we just kind of run through them real quick. There's lots of groups here to connect during the week. This past Wednesday, we had a dinner at the Hope House, and it was kind of crowded, but I kind of liked it. It was different, and we had all kinds of cool food, good food. I had two of those donuts, whoever left them, the next morning. They were like, hey, eat me, and I ate them both by 6 a.m. Crazy. But and then there's a group on a Zoom group Wednesday mornings for it's a women's prayer group. There's the new small group. We're going to do a group called Everyday Advent for those dates starting this Wednesday at 7:10 p.m. over there. And there's also another group that meets Saturday mornings in Zoom. They pray, they talk, they look at a psalm, and then also, is your group meeting today?
Next Sunday.
Okay, next Sunday. Ruth and Will are meeting next week. And then we just want to let you know that these are just some things that are going on that we connect with. The Mid-United Ministries Food Pantry, they collect, they're on Veers Mill Road. They do a little a truck of sorts in different locations. And it's mostly 20906 is one of their zip codes. And so like for Thanksgiving, let's fill that kitchen up, bring stuff in. And that'll be delivered roughly the 19th or before Thanksgiving. And then the water well is pushing, we're getting close. We're at 60-something percent probably. And Angels of Addiction. Patty, we still are collecting things that she gives to people on the streets in Baltimore through blankets, gloves. She tries to get people into rehab, the whole nine yards. So we want to continue to, I'll take some of that over pretty soon to her over towards the airport. That's where she has a storage unit. And just always want to keep connected with you about Haiti. We still are part of that. The kids are fed, there's still church going, but we're just not going for a long time. It's dangerous. We shouldn't be going to Haiti right now. And then also, the due date is 2 weeks today for the Operation Christmas Child boxes. And then I believe, Katie, we have yeah, we do. Leanne left you with this one.
My name is Yulia Shubina. I was born and raised in a closed country in Central Asia. In November 2001, an aircraft filled with thousands of Operation Christmas Child shoebox gifts landed in my country. And that was the year when I received my shoebox. Coming from a closed country where the gospel wasn't allowed to be shared openly, the shoebox and its contents were a personal expression of God's love to me. My absolute favorite item was a stuffed animal dog that I still have today. But not until years later, when I became a Christian, did I realize that the most important item in the shoebox was the letter from the girl who packed it for me. The reason I say that is because she ended that letter with one simple sentence, "I am praying for you." It planted the seeds and stirred my curiosity in who the Lord is and why someone who has never met me all the way across the ocean in a different part of the world decided to not only bless me with all those wonderful items, but also to bless me with their prayers. The shoeboxes that you pack really do have an eternal impact on the children who receive them all over the world. They bring hope, they bring love, and they fill their hearts with joy, the joy that only Jesus can give. Thank you for packing shoeboxes and making stories like mine possible.
Pretty cool. Children are dismissed. And I am going to pray. All right, man, there's a lot to pray for, right? Right? Come on, we can talk, right? There's a lot to pray for, right? I watched the news for 3 seconds and I was on my knees. So, a lot to pray for. So, we want to pray for the body of Christ. We want to pray for, you know, what we see going on in the world. And let's just pray. Jesus, we thank you today for Will being here. He's missed a few weeks. We continue to pray for Shannon and every member of our church, if they're here or not today. I think of Kevin Wheeler as he's out on his job this morning. And Lord, we are blessed to be part of a community of believers. Father, Lord, this morning, we just pray for the world. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We pray against hate in every way it is about. Lord, like, help us, Jesus. Lord, this morning, we lift up to you just our world. We lift up to you the chaos that we see, let alone the chaos in our own hearts this morning. Lord, we lift up to you, as I said earlier, maybe a lack of common sense, so many things. Lord, we lift up to you this body of Christ. We pray for the child that will get a box from this church 1,000 miles away from here, more. And God, you will use that because we work through people for the kingdom of God. Oh, there's so many stories like that video. Lord, we pray for that. Lord, and Lord, help remind us today that we are a people that are not without hope, but we're a people with hope. Not because of us, but because of Christ and the resurrection. We have hope. We always have hope in Christ and our circumstances, the world's circumstances, that you are God still. It's not like all of a sudden, no, you're not God, but you're still God, living. Not dead, but living. Lord, help us find refuge in you this morning. Help us find strength in you this morning. Help us find that power within the Spirit of God in us this morning. And help us be still and know that you're God. Lord, we pray for the body of Christ. We pray for Kay Barrett and her back. Lord, we pray for Esther, Ruth's sister. We pray for Cadiz and Don Pacone for healing. Angie Chan, as she may have a procedure down the road. For Nina and Patty Gogo and Shannon and Heather Johnson with cancer and Glory Mater going through chemo because of cancer. Lord, we lift up this church. We lift up finances. We lift up every aspect of this church. And Lord, we thank you that we can come here. We thank you that we can laugh. I see the laughter. I see the conversations. I see the joy in getting together with others. Regardless if we stand up and clap or we sit there and truly listen, it's still the same thing, that we're here because of you. So Lord, I ask today that just help us in our journeys. Lord, I pray that we would I say this all the time, that each and every one of us would have come to Jesus moments, that your spirit would say, hey, wait a second, what's going on here in this area or that? And that we would be obedient to you. Lord, help us know if there's no one here today, if there's someone here today that thinks God can't possibly love me or forgive me, that's a lie from hell. May we run towards the grace and mercy seat of God through Christ. We thank you for this church. We thank you for all the things you do for us. And Lord, we pray this in the name above every name. The one who is the Lord of Lords, King of Kings, the bright and morning star, the one that has come in grace and will come in judgment. He is the one who is God. The one that is proclaimed clearly that there is hope beyond the grave. May we hold on to you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Gonna have one more video. Now, I'm not gonna mention the video. This is a freebie. But I want you to take in this video because it will kind of just throw some terms in your head. And I think it will help kind of lay some foundation of what it means to serve. So this is out of Luke 13. And this is Jesus washing feet. Okay? Thank you.
What was the significance of Jesus washing the feet of the disciples? Jesus washing the feet of the disciples occurred in the upper room during the Last Supper and has significance in three ways. For Jesus, it was the display of his humility and his servanthood. For the disciples, the washing of their feet was in direct contrast to their hard attitudes at that time. For us, washing feet is symbolic of our role in the body of Christ. Walking in sandals on the filthy roads of Israel in the first century made it imperative that feet be washed before a communal meal, especially since people reclined at a low table and feet were very much in evidence. When Jesus rose from the table and began to wash the feet of the disciples, he was doing the work of the lowliest of servants. The disciples must have been stunned at this act of humility and condescension, that Christ, their Lord and Master, should wash the feet of his disciples when it was their proper work to have washed his. But when Jesus came to earth the first time, he came not as a king and conqueror, but as the suffering servant of Isaiah 53. As he revealed in Matthew 20:28, he came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. The humility expressed by his act with towel and basin foreshadowed his ultimate act of humility and love on the cross. Jesus' attitude of servanthood was in direct contrast to that of the disciples, who had recently been arguing among themselves as to which of them was the greatest. Since there was no servant present to wash their feet, it would never have occurred to them to wash one another's feet. When the Lord himself stooped to this lowly task, they were stunned into silence. To his credit, though, Peter was profoundly uncomfortable with the Lord washing his feet, and, never being at a loss for words, Peter protested, "You shall never wash my feet." Then Jesus said something that must have further shocked Peter, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me," prompting Peter, whose love for his Savior was genuine, to request a complete washing. Then Jesus explained the true meaning of being washed by him. Peter had experienced the cleansing of salvation and did not need to be washed again in the spiritual sense. Salvation is a one-time act of justification by faith, but the lifelong process of sanctification is one of washing from the stain of sin we experience as we walk through the world. Peter and the disciples, all except Judas, who never belonged to Christ, needed only this temporal cleansing. This truth is just one of several from this incident that Christians can apply to their own lives. First, when we come to Christ for the washing of our sins, we can be sure that it's permanent and complete. No act can cleanse us further from our sin, as our sin has been exchanged for the perfect righteousness of Christ on the cross. But we do need continual cleansing from the effects of living in the flesh in a sin-cursed world. The continual washing of sanctification is done by the power of the Holy Spirit who lives within us through the washing of water by the Word given to us to equip us for every good work. Further, when Jesus washed the disciples' feet, he told them and us, "I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you." As his followers, we are to emulate him, serving one another in lowliness of heart and mind, seeking to build one another up in humility and love. When we seek the preeminence, we displease the Lord, who promised that true greatness in his kingdom is attained by those with a servant's heart. When we have the servant's heart, the Lord promised we will be greatly blessed. Got questions? The Bible has answers, and we'll...
That's some pretty good stuff. That's some seminary money right there. I'd rather watch that stuff than being taught in a lecture. But I'm going to read to you a number of scriptures again. Actually, sometimes when I do this, especially with this particular kind of message series, I'm not going to even touch some of them. Especially, I just realized that Luke 7's up there. I'm not going to even touch it. But I'm going to read most of them to you, and then we're going to get moving along here. And one of the things we're going to talk about today is you were shaped to serve God. You were shaped to serve God. So let me read some of these. Kind of put that video in your head. That was a real good lesson. And then add some of these scriptures. And this is one of my favorite verses. I like the Message translation best. But John 1:14 basically says, Jesus walked through the neighborhood in the flesh and blood. In flesh and blood. He moved through the neighborhoods, basically spontaneously as well. So the Word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness. And we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father, one and only Son. Jesus, if you want to know what God is like, take a look at Jesus. Okay? Here's another verse. Ephesians 2:8 through 10. God saved us by his grace when you believe. You can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so we can boast about it. Now this part, we got to include. For we are God's masterpiece. Some translations say workmanship. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do good things he planned for us long ago. Ephesians 4:7. However, he has given each one of us a special gift through the generosity of Christ. Work willingly at whatever you do, as though you were working for the Lord rather than for people. You're getting all this in your head, right? Okay. Couple more. 1 Peter 4:10, I like another translation. You are all called to be ministers. That's basically what that verse right there is saying. You are called to be ministers. Matthew 20:28, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Now, let me just add on to this. The first time Jesus came, Christmas is coming. Jesus comes in grace, right? But Jesus is coming back someday in judgment, because he's the King of all kings. Let me get another verse. And the parts we regard as less honorable are those we clothe with the greatest care. Meaning, don't get paranoid because someone has this gift and you don't have this gift. You can serve God from the lowly to the top. It doesn't matter. It's all gifts that God has given us. It's important to know. And this, I think I conclude with this. Philippians 2, don't be selfish. I've never been selfish. Is anyone? Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look only for your own interests, but take interest in others too. You must have that same attitude that Christ Jesus had. I'm not going to do this one. And we saw the washing of the feet. So, I don't know what time it is, and that's because it's blinking, so that's to your disadvantage. I don't want to know. She was going to have to tell me. But I hope you got some good sleep tonight. You got an extra hour of sleep.
Yeah,
I feel a little energized, and I have a huge coffee here that helps. And I don't know about you, but like I've been really tired lately. And last Wednesday night, after we had that group, I was playing ice hockey, and I literally was trying to get a puck with this young guy, beat me to it. And I went full speed, head on into the boards, and I hit the ground, and I felt like I had a concussion, but I was pretty sure I wasn't. And at the last second, I put my arms up, and my arms stopped me, kind of. I still hit my head pretty hard, and my arms have been hurting, like, for days, like a jolt, like a car accident. So I don't know what it is. Maybe I'm just getting older, which I am, but I felt really tired. But I got to tell you, you need to talk this morning. I feel so energized. I got 8 hours sleep. I got caffeine in me. And this was an extra bonus because I already had caffeine before I got this caffeine. So I'm ready to roll today. You ready to roll? This is the word of God. This is good stuff. And I know people will try to talk you out of Jesus. And, oh, that word of God's ancient. It doesn't mean anything today. Well, I would tend to disagree. So we're here this morning. And I really mean I'm glad you're here. And like I want to talk to you, if you haven't been here, this journey we've been going on, okay? I'm going to go to it really quickly. We've been doing this for roughly 5 weeks. Next week's probably the last week. And we first asked the question, what am I here for? And we kind of theme-wise, you're made for eternity. You're here for God. It's about God. And then we looked at the scriptures, and we looked, what's the purpose of a believer? And one of the answers was to worship God, right? Not contained in the building, though it's the building, but it's not the building, it's wherever you go, okay? You're to worship God in everything you say and do and your obedience to him. And then we talked about, oh, I'm a believer, so I need to belong. I need to belong to a church family. Not necessarily the building again, but a group of people, like-minded, when we come together. And like I said a couple times already, some people clap, some people frozen chosen, but it's all from the heart, right? And that's cool, and that's what God wants. And then we talked about last week that one of the purposes of a Christian's life is to look like Christ. Someone goes, man, I want some of that, right? And that's just to be Christ-like. You can't miss that. It's all through the Bible. I mean, if you can't find it, you're not looking for it, okay? And then today we're going to talk about, like the idea, we're going to talk about that you and I are shaped. Say that word, shaped. Shaped. You're shaped for serving God. actually says you're shaped and serving God before you basically were born, that God has plans for you long ago. He was going to shape you for certain things. Okay? So let me tell you a quick story. When Aaron and Mallory were little kids, we would go upstairs on the bed, you know, we'd talk to them before they went to bed, and the dog, Shelby, wouldn't lay on one of the beds. She was always included. She's still a kid. And she would sit on the bed, and there was this time, I don't remember where it came to, where one day after we were reading a story to them, we started blowing bubbles. You know, like bubbles. I'm going to do it in a second. Don't try to know. And we started blowing bubbles, and the dog, Shelby, she's 12 years old now, and she would go crazy. We'd go, and she would wait for the bubble and bite it and get all excited, and then she'd do it, and then she got really skilled at it, and we'd blow the bubbles, and before it even came to her mouth, she would jump up and get three bubbles at once. She was like Michael Jordan in the air, and she was so excited, and it was crazy, but she loved bubbles. And then after she was done, she smelled like bubbles, you know? But she would jump at them and get excited and all these things. And I was thinking this week, and I tried to find bubbles all week. I went to three stores, then I realized that the church had bubbles. I hate when that happens. When you go to like five stores or something. Where are they? Oh, they're in the room down there. Okay. But I want to talk to you about bubbles for a second. I was thinking about this. See, let me show you some. Bubbles come in all shapes and sizes. Bubbles come in all shapes and sizes. One size isn't better than another size, but bubbles come in all shapes and sizes. What I'm trying to tell you before we get going here this morning is don't get hung up with that person's size bubble. Oh, what could they do in the church where, oh, that person speaks and that person, oh, this and that. I don't care. Bubbles come in all shapes and sizes, and God has shaped you for serving in the various sizes and things of ministry. Okay? Bubbles come in all shapes and sizes, and God makes bubbles in different shapes and sizes to shape you to the things He wants you to do. I think that's really important. Because we get hung up, I'm going to tell you a story in like a couple minutes. We get hung up in, oh, well, they're a pastor, or they're this. And it's like, you know what? We're all ministers. We're all called. We're all shaped to do the things of God. Not by works, but with an outflow of a redeemed, filled heart of Christ. Bubbles shape us, and they come in all shapes and sizes. When you gave your life to Christ, and you got your sins forgiven, again, you can be forgiven for any sin in confession. Christ comes to forgive you of his sin. You know what happens? We confessed our sins, we turned to God, right? And God put the Holy Spirit in us. I talked last week that it's the same Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead, and he gives you the power, not your power, but the Spirit of God, humility before the Spirit of God to do the things of God. And he raised Jesus from the dead, that same Spirit, and saving of your sins, that God would then, because the Spirit is in you, begin to shape you in order to serve Christ. God works through people, amen? Right? God works through people. He does his own thing too, but he works through people. I mean, we look at the Scripture, we look at our lives. God is working through people, and bubbles come in shapes and sizes. That's one of the things I want you to get for your leave. I heard Tim Tebow, if you know who he is, recently speak. He's a really good speaker. And Tim Tebow said this. You are saved from something, yes. And what he's referring to, if you listen, to your sins. Yes, we are saved from our sins. That's really, 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 really important. That's the gospel, the guts of the gospel. But God saved us not just from our sins, right? Yes, go with me on this here. I'm telling you, it is your sins. But God saved you in order that you would then serve him with a heart of God inside. Because it is completely unnatural to serve. Now, we can have a social cause that we're really good at, and that's great. But God still has to change your heart to be saved. Your social cause is not your salvation. God is your salvation. And through a redeemed heart, we want to do the good things of God, the things of the kingdom of God. And our bubbles are formed in shapes, different shapes and sizes. And you have gifts that someone else doesn't have. Okay? You have gifts that someone else doesn't have. Yes, fruit of the Spirit. I say that every week. You got to be displaying fruits of the Spirit, fruit of the Spirit. I love the Beatitudes and the Sermon on the Mount. That should be flowing out of us. But God also has been shaping you for gifts that other people don't have. And you can't go around going, well, Grace has this, and Grace, and that person has that. Here's something that I should never be allowed to work in a church. Anything technological, any sound system, anything related to microphones, anything even walking into that room, I should never be allowed in. And for some people, that's their gig. I shouldn't teach Sunday school. They should yank me out as fast as possible. But God has shaped people to do those things. God has shaped people to walk into areas you and I will never walk into, like Patty Lee, for say, and God has shaped her for that. And maybe she shaped you for something different. And that doesn't mean you try it. Don't try it. I was a prison chaplain. God shaped me for that. And some people go, I can't believe you go in there. Okay? But I can't believe that you teach Sunday school. You see the thing? Moses said to God, I'm not a good speaker. And Jesus, God's like, I don't care what you think. Watch you leave. Right? David sinned, and David, we sit all through the Psalms and the sins and Samuel, and all of a sudden, oh my gosh, my sin's so great, how could God ever use you? And what does he call a man after God's own heart? Don't let someone say, well, you've sinned and you did A, B, C, D, F, G. Oh my gosh, you never can use my God. That's a lie from hell. God actually uses us from our trauma and our pain to serve others. God will use you maybe from the very own sins of your life, and God will use that to serve him. Things that maybe you've done that I haven't done, but I've done things that you haven't done, and he moves you in places because you can understand and relate, maybe perhaps a little better. Someone sins. God uses people. God uses people to God uses people, save people, and that they would serve him. 25 years or so ago, I add 10 years onto that, there's this man named Todd Marinovich. Does anyone know who Todd Marinovich is?
Quarterback.
Yeah. He's probably 50 years old now. And Todd Marinovich was this guy in Los Angeles area. His dad was a football coach. And his dad's whole purpose in life was to make sure his son Todd made it to the NFL. It's documented, look it up. And he wasn't allowed to eat fast food, no McDonald's. He threw a football every day since he was like 5 years old. They had him in like these reflex training every day. He lifted weights, he had a schedule. Like I said, never could eat fast food. He was on this regimented diet and all this stuff for all these years. And you know what, he was actually a good athlete. And then he got to high school, and all these colleges were like, we want him. He went to USC, and you got to be pretty good to get there as an athlete. I don't know about intellectually. And he made it to the NFL. He lasted 2 years. I'm going to stop the story with that. It's a complicated story if you want to read it. He was being shaped for something. His dad's goal in life was to be shaped that you make it to the NFL. God is shaping us to serve him. I think one of the greatest cool things is that John 1:14, spontaneously, I threw that in there. It's in there somewhere. Walking through the neighborhood and finding ways to serve people. In our class, we took Love and Chaos. That's all the man talked about, is spontaneously working with people, serving people. Not a planned event necessarily, which is good, but spontaneously helping people, reaching out to people in the name of Christ, serving people. God is shaping us. Here's the thing with the shaping of God. And I'm going to say this twice here. What you listen to and who you listen to is shaping you whether you want to believe it or not. Mm-hmm. What you listen to and what goes into your brain is shaping you without, regardless if you don't want to believe that or not. Mm-hmm. The question always comes down to is who will you serve? God is shaping each and every one of us to serve him. There was a recent psychological study, and I don't have the date to it, but and the people started struggling to find purpose in their life. And as they started trying to find purpose for their life, they said, well, it has a lot to do with COVID, it has a lot to do with this and this and this. And at the end of this, the issue was, again, I said that they were trying to find purpose in their lives. And the study at the end said, help others, that will help you find purpose in your life. And I'm going with that. That lines up with God. You know, the first four commandments, love God, love God, love God. 6 through 10, if you love God, serve others, serve others, serve others, love people. Help others. Be the Jesus that someone needs to see. In your neighborhood, a neighbor, we know, we've gone over this, is a person made in God's image. Your neighbor isn't necessarily next door, but your neighbor could be in Hawaii right now, you know? You know, and all those kind of things. But in that class that we just finished, he said specifically, he was talking about like your next door neighbor, your neighbor down the street, your neighbor four doors away. Bake them a pie, go get to know them. That's serving God, get to know them. And if they have an emergency, you know, don't send it back to you in 7 days. Stop what you're doing, interrupt your life for the sake of serving someone in the name of Christ. In the name of Christ, get to know your neighbor. For your neighbor, when it's inconvenient, when life interrupts your life, still get to know your neighbor. When you'd rather not, still get to know your neighbor. When you're tired and they come by, get to know your neighbor. Not just when it's convenient. Not always the planned events, but the spontaneous events in our lives. The things that happen every day. To serve others, which is serving God. To serve others, that God is forming in you and shaping you, and I'm talking gifts as well, is serving others. I was on the phone the other day with a friend, and he's in the Dominican Republic right now. He took 35 people on a medical mission in the Dominican Republic. And he was leaving the next day, and I said, this is prior to that, a couple days prior to that, and I said to him, what are you doing tonight? He goes to South Carolina. He said, you know what? My wife and I finally called our neighbor up and we invited them for dinner. We keep talking about it, but we never do it. And they're coming over for dinner. And I'm going, wow, I think that's what God's talking about. Those kind of things, you know? All those kind of things. When it's easy when you know someone, right? Right, when it's inconvenient. Like the other day, Pooja's daughter hurt her ankle and my Mallory was with her. And I went to bed at 9:45 on a Saturday night. That's called 61 and up. And I had my phone on. I was really like, I went to bed and I saw this light from a distance. And I was like, I'm not answering it. It's inconvenient. And it was Mallory saying, hey, could you pick me up at what hospital was that? Holy Cross. And so I did it because it was Mallory. It was convenient. I'm supposed to offer, right? And we're supposed to love their neighbors too, but like, it's easy when it's someone you know. But God's calling us to strangers. I'm making it more generic right now. There aren't gifts that you have, that some people have, that you don't have, and you stop comparing, we'll get to that in a second. But it's not just for who you know. God's pushing us to believers. Like, the world, I believe in evangelism, like Billy Graham, and they say things, right? I still believe God uses all that stuff, but I'm telling you, we live in a pulse culture. I'm telling you, I think more and more you have to get to know your person. You have to get to know your neighbor. And God can do it either way. But if people, you know, you got to connect with people. Ephesians 2:8-10 says this. Ready for this? He's talking to you. God saved you by his grace. Amen? Amen. Not works. If you hear I say the word works, you're not hearing me. God saved you. It's by faith alone that you are saved. It is not by works. Okay? It is not by works. And God saved you, the second part, by what he has done for you on the cross and his resurrection. It is a free gift from God. Okay, we're clear on that. It's not works. It is by faith that you've been saved. And a lot of times when we get to that Ephesians 2:8-9, we go, I love Ephesians 2:8. God saved me. It's a free gift. But then he throws 9 and 10. And he says, okay, so at 8, I hold on to my salvation card. But then he says, But by the way, one of the purposes of our life, the Spirit and your salvation of a changed heart and a natural flow of grace is acts of serving people that I've given you and planned for you long ago. That we serve God for kingdom purposes. Again, the Operation Christmas Child, that story, that person will never know you, but God's using it and working through it, and you have an impact. You don't know where that box is even going 90% of the time. God still uses it, right? God still uses it. See, it's more than just we are the church right here, but we're the church and the church and the church, the universal church. Don't be confused. What I mean is in Jesus Christ, they call that a universal church, not in universalism, but in the church of Jesus as in you're saved by Christ alone. The church isn't just here, but the church is in Korea right now in a service. The church is in North Korea and hiding in a service. It's big in the name of Jesus Christ. And listen to what Jesus says, and or Paul says in Ephesians, and in some translations it says workmanship. It says, you are God's masterpiece. You're God's masterpiece. He saved you, it's a gift, and then he has things for you to do, planned long ago, and by the way, because of salvation and to the world, you're God's masterpiece. Look to the world. Look, they're saved. There's hope beyond the grave. There's heaven. There's things in the kingdom. Wow, we're God's masterpiece. Now, when I think of a great painting, that's what I think of with a masterpiece. Do you know what? I don't know the picture of it, but there's this picture of this painting that's real popular. It's called Scream. You know what I'm talking about? The person's like this. Ah. It's worth a lot of money, the original. At least over a buck. Probably millions. Millions, this painting. And people actually go see the original of Scream in a museum. And they line up and they go, ooh, ah, ooh, ah. Let me show you a picture I think is way more of a masterpiece. You ready? Jesus running after us. The lost sheep. Jesus' death, the resurrection. And he got the 99 to what? It doesn't take a rescue, just will. Though you need a lot of rescue. But he did come to rescue each and every one of us. That's the masterpiece of Christ to the world. It's also a changed heart that we would serve others. Because God has been shaping us and planning things for us before we were even born. That he long planned long ago. That painting to me is priceless. That's the ultimate masterpiece. His plans are shaping you and I to be different than others. No one's greater because they stand here or play music or they do the books of the church or things outside the church. No one's better than others. You know? Like Jesus to me was like the CEO of a company. He is the CEO of the world. But he's the CEO of a company and you're like, what are you doing? He's mopping the kitchen floor late at night. He's a suffering servant. He came to serve. He's not like, I am God, and I don't hold mops. No, he gets dirty with us, and he came to serve. 1 Peter 4:10 says this, and I paraphrase, that we are all ministers. That's the paraphrase. That is actually, a lot of translations calls it. You are all ministers with abilities that God has given you. In fact, the Lord has been shaping you for that long before you even came to Christ. Let me tell you a secret. Can I tell you a secret this morning? Can we take the tape off for a second? Okay. You know what the job of a pastor is? To get fired. Because everything's working in, like pistons in an engine. That everyone finds their gifts outside the church and inside the walls. That everything is just moving. I don't want to get fired. My point is, you understand my point, because the person here, the male or female, they're no better than you. You are all called to serve Christ. Everyone has a role. You know, sometimes I'll watch preachers, and I love Erwin McManus. Some of you might know who he is. He's a brilliant speaker. And I go, oh, I wish I was like Erwin. And God's like, be quiet, you're never going to be Erwin, you're rich. You know, that's what he's telling all of us. Because some of the roles, like even in a church or outside the church, you may be the one that's cleaning up the napkins with chicken wings on the floor. That counts. You may be the person that can has the ability to come up here and lead worship. That counts. You may be the person on the streets that no one even hears about that you shared with someone Christ the other day in the gym. That counts. And you may not get the fanfare and all this, but it counts. In fact, the danger in the Christian evangelical culture, that might sound a little weird, but we have celebrity pastors. They preach the word of God, a lot of them, and they fall because they become celebrities. And you can chew on that and wrestle with that. That's all right. Wow! They're just a dude. They're just a woman. That's all they are. So, let me just explain that a little more. You are all called to be ministers, right? Amen? Right. So, let me tell you, I got a phone call. Whatever, I went to Florida about a month ago, and I visited my great friend from college named Glenn. He's the guy who told me he owns a coffee business. It's incredible. And he was this guy who was a knucklehead in college, and he's a businessman. I don't get it. But, and he's really smart. He's an entrepreneur. I mean, he's unbelievable. And he said, oh, I still hang out with Mike, this guy Mike. From college, and I really haven't come. I was friends with him, but I don't keep in touch. He does. I just saw him 3 months ago. My wife and I visited his wife in Pensacola, Florida. Talked to him all the time. Oh, Mike Mojo, wow. And he said, hey, I said, hey, you want to call Mike? So he gave me my number, and I called Mike, left a message. A week went by, he called me. I didn't call back. And then I think it was last week on a Saturday afternoon, he called me. And we talked for like 20 minutes. He said, I hope I can see you with Glenn someday. Let's plan on it. Whatever. So let me tell you about Mike real quick, okay? Just stay with me, okay? This guy's unbelievable. This guy's crazy almost. He's so unbelievable to me. He went to college to be a pastor when I met him. He was going to get his undergrad and then go to seminary. He decided to go to the Army and become a chaplain or a pastor and let them pay for it. He's in the Army for 2 years, and so, I don't know all the details. Then he switches over to the Navy in his third year, and then he flies fighter helicopter. He's a fighter helicopter pilot in the Navy on the aircraft carriers. And he's so good at flying these things that after like 15 years of flying them, they said, you are so good at this, we want you to train pilots to fly. He does that for another 10 years, so that's one pension, okay? He's 20 years in the Navy, and all this, when he's doing all these things, he gets involved somehow in cyber defense. I don't even get that with a computer. I can barely do Google. So he's doing cybersecurity for a private company. He's really excelling at it. And let me tell you, okay, I'm getting there. Okay, so he's doing the computer security. He's doing it. He moves to Alabama for this company. He's been there for 15 years. He's so good at it, and he's such a humble guy that three schools now have him teach classes via Zoom. He's so good at it. It's like an elective they take. And he's like, I love it, Rich. And I share my faith kind of, and they don't even know it. And all these things, and he's doing all these. And then I found out that he's a realtor on the side, and he still plays tennis. He's one of the most gifted tennis players I've ever met in my life. Wow. And he sleeps 8 hours a day, somehow. But this is what he said to me at the end. And I don't want to put different words in here. He said, but you get to do the kingdom. Because I think there's some guilt that he didn't follow what he thought he should follow. And know what I said to him? I said, Mike, yeah, I get what you're saying. But you have been in places, in jobs, with all various types of people. And you have continued to be who you are. And you've shared Christ, and you've lived Christ, and you have served others. Don't compare, because I crave that sometimes. When you crave, I crave what you have. Do you know what I'm saying? Bubbles come in all shapes and sizes, and God still calls every one of us to serve Christ. It says in Philippians, Jesus was equal with God, but he came to serve in humility. An attitude of humility. Again, the idea of CEO mops the floors late at night. You ever watch that show, Undercover Boss? They actually do those kind of things, you know? So I think what the Lord is telling us is this. In the spontaneous things of life, that God has called you to serve in and serve the kingdom. In your opportunities that he gives you, everyone's opportunity, everyone's bubble is a different shape and size. No one is really, I'm better than you, you're better than me. It's all part of the kingdom. And God's going to put you places in companies and businesses where you're going to have opportunities that someone maybe in this realm doesn't have like you. But God uses all of us. God has called us to serve him. Look at the opportunities to serve. Pay attention to people's needs. Have eyes with compassion. It's not thinking less about ourselves, it's thinking about ourselves less. So I'm going to close real quick. You guys know who Jim Caviezel is? The guy that played Jesus in The Passion? I'm going to read something that you've probably heard before. He was speaking to a group of people in ministry, I don't know, generically. Listen to what he says. This is so powerful. Can you hear his voice a little? Have you heard it? Has anyone ever heard him speak? His voice is like, when he talks, you're like, yes, I'm listening. It's like this voice. And he says, he's talking about Jesus. My commandment to you is this, that you love one another. And if that does not grab you, maybe this one will. Your name may not appear on the world's hall of fame. In fact, you may be so unknown that no one knows your name. The Oscars and the praise of men may never come your way, but don't forget that God has some rewards that he will hand out someday. The crowd on earth, they will cheer like mad until you fall, and their praise will stop. Not God, he never does. And in God's Hall of Fame, by just believing on his Son, forever is your name. I tell you, friend, I wouldn't trade my name, however small, is written there beyond the stars in the celestial hall. For all the famed names on earth, or the glory that they share, I'd rather be an unknown here and have my name up there. God is calling us to serve the kingdom, not the bright lights, not the recognition, but the kingdom of God. We are shaped to serve God. This morning, if you don't have a communion cup, Dave, could you grab them? Abe's going to bless the bread, and I'm going to bless the cup. And just when you take communion today, we're reminded of what Christ has done for us. But remind yourselves, in a sense, what God has called us to be. And it says in the scriptures, until he comes again. Every time we take communion together, we're reminded of what Christ has done for us and where and when he comes again.
Of your righteousness.
on that same night, as they took the bread, Jesus took the cup and he said, this cup represents forgiveness of sins, a new covenant. It's not by the death of animals, of sacrifice. It's the new covenant, the blood of Christ. Without the forgiveness of sins, there's no salvation. Every time we take the bread, we take the cup together, we remember what Christ has done for us. I believe what Christ has called for us, and that Christ will come again in a crazy world. I don't know the date, but God does. So every time we take this, we collectively remember what Christ has done for us. This blood he shed on the cross for us. Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sins. He is the final, once and for all sacrifice. Take.